we're looking at how a government finances its budget deficit. The source material lays out three fundamental options: taxes, issuing bonds, so taking loans, and printing money, which is known as seigniorage.
And the real question for us is whether the material is right to treat seigniorage as a truly independent primary source, you know, on the same level as taxation or debt.
Exactly. I'll be arguing that the source's classification of three distinct methods does in fact validate seigniorage's status as a unique alternative.
And I'm going to push back on that. I think the way the material defines seigniorage actually undermines its status as a parallel policy choice. I think it frames it more as a consequence than a deliberate option.
Well, let me start there, because what I find compelling is that the source material really forces this three-way distinction. A government has to decide, right? It can tax, which is a direct levy. It can issue bonds, which, you know, creates a future debt, or it can use seigniorage. And this last option, printing money, is explicitly defined as what the government does when it bypasses the other two. I mean, the mechanism itself, creating currency for almost nothing, is so operationally different that it absolutely deserves its own category.
I see that, but I think that view misses a really crucial point about the economic implications. Taxes, okay, they have an immediate, very visible cost. Bonds have a delayed, but still visible cost. You have to pay them back. Seigniorage, though, is presented by the source simply as the thing you do when you don't do those. That framing, to me, suggests it's not a true policy lever in the same way. It's more of an implicit consequence that just imposes the hidden cost of inflation. The source treats them like three equal doors, but economically, I think there's a clear hierarchy of choice.
Right. But if we focus only on the syntax of the definition, we're sort of ignoring the economic clarity the categories give us. The source is highlighting three different operational choices. When there's a deficit, it has to be covered. So, if a government decides against the political pain of taxes and the future burden of debt, it is actively choosing the third path, creating money. The fact that this choice is often a last resort doesn't make it any less of a choice. If anything, that just highlights its essential role when the other tools aren't available.
Okay, but is it an independent choice? I mean, that's the core of it. If we accept your reading, how do you then square the inflationary cost with the, let's say, direct and measurable cost of taxes or debt? The source draws this neat line between them, but in reality, all three options are just different ways of extracting wealth from the private economy. And, you know, there's another layer here. Modern economies separate these things. The Treasury handles taxes and bonds, but an independent central bank usually manages the money supply. So the source's neat three-way split sort of papers over that critical institutional reality that really limits seigniorage as a free choice for the government.
That's a fair point on the institutions, but the source material is focused on the macroeconomic tools available to the state as a whole. It doesn't really matter which agency is pulling the lever. The three mechanical options are still there. You can demand revenue now, promise it later, or create it now. The fundamental difference in those mechanics is what justifies the source's classification of three separate funding paths.
I see why you're emphasizing the mechanics. I do. But I still maintain that classifying seigniorage as just what happens not through taxes and not through bonds locks it into a residual role. That definitional link is what raises these questions about its status as a primary tool. And understanding that nuance forces us to weigh the true trade-offs. An immediate cost, a delayed debt, or, you know, a hidden inflationary tax.
In the end, I think the source material gives us a clear and essential breakdown of deficit funding. That framework emphasizes the unique operational nature of seigniorage. It's a distinct choice with its own unique consequences, regardless of how politically palatable it is.
And for me, that very definition rooted in the absence of the other two means we just have to analyze seigniorage differently. The complex trade-offs in deficit management really come to light when we admit that these three sources are not perfectly symmetrical policy instruments. There's certainly a lot more to explore in how these methods actually shift the economic burden across society and over time.